I'm sure you have heard of the saying that Christians are people of the book, right? You've heard that. We are people of the book. Why is it that we are people of the book? The reason we are people of the book is because the book points us to the cross, and the cross is where we see our Savior. That's why we love the Bible, because we love Jesus who is presented to us in the Bible. And I hope today, as we spend time in Colossians 3, as we then contemplate the death and resurrection of Jesus, that's whom we see brighter. That's whom we see fuller. That's whom we fall in love deeper. Now, one of the things that we got around to as a family during this quarantine time is watching the new Pilgrim's Progress cartoon. We have a number of versions of the story, in kids' versions and adult versions, but there's a new cartoon that came out, and we was for free, so we finally sat down and watched it as a family. Now, how many of you have seen the cartoon that I'm talking about? Hey, so a few of you. It's pretty well done. It's a little bit more, that was going to be more childish. It's for a little bit older kids, I would say. How many of you have read the book, Pilgrim's Progress? Hey, very good. So most of you probably remember at least some parts of the story. The story represents what a Christian life involves. If you remember, at the very beginning, we find a man whose name is Christian, who has found a book, and in that book he has discovered that the city that he lives in will be destroyed, and he needs to flee. Now, in addition to that bad news, he's also got these filthy clothing, and he's got this huge weight on his shoulder that he can't take off. Now, anywho, in the beginning of the story, as Christian is sitting and weeping and he doesn't know what to do, he meets a man by the name of Evangelist. Here's their conversation. Christian asks Evangelist, "Where must I flee?" Evangelist replies, "Do you see the narrow gate over there?" "No," the Christian replies. "Well, do you see the shining light there?" "I think I do," replies Christian. "Keep that light in your eye and go directly toward it. Then you will see the gate. When you come to the gate, you will be told what you must do." Now that seems easy enough, doesn't it? See the light? Keep it in your purview and make your way towards that way. Now, the story is not so simple. Do you remember what does Christian meet on his way to the narrow gate? And after it, what does he encounter? Lots and lots of obstacles. Doesn't he? Anybody remember any of them? You can just shout it out. You remember, what are some of the obstacles? Doubtful, right? What else? Doubting castle. What else? Levi, was that you? Yeah, the very first one is actually, they fell in this muddy river that almost drowned them, right? Now, I'm sure as you think back, you can remember a number of them. And probably if you've watched the cartoon or you've read the book, those are probably the parts that resonate most with you, are the things that Christian meets on the road. In other words, in order for Christian to reach his destination, he doesn't just need to know where to go, but he also needs to be able to overcome the many, many obstacles that he faces on his way to the celestial city. Now, last week, if you remember, we looked at Colossians chapter 3, and we considered the question of what does a life in service to Jesus look like? In some sense, we were talking about the shining light, the narrow gate. Where are you supposed to be headed? We talked about how this life is a life that is motivated by Jesus. It's a life that sees every aspect of what it does, of what it's involved in, as a service to Jesus. It doesn't separate things into the secular and sacred. It doesn't see some things as done for the flesh and other things as done for the spirit. Not only that, it is a life. And we see, by the way, we see this quite a bit in Pilgrim's Progress, so beautifully displayed, is that it's a life that expects Jesus to reward it with an eternal inheritance. Now, when we come back to our text today, I want to look at that other side of the equation, and that is to think about what are the obstacles, what are some obstacles that you and I meet, encounter on our way as we seek to live a life that is in service to Jesus. And so here's the main question, if you can put it up there. Here's the main question that I want us to answer as we look at Colossians chapter 3, verses 3:22 through 4:1. And that is the question that I want to ask you. Whether you remember last week's sermon or not, whether you were here or not, what obstacles do you personally, individually, face in living a life of service to Jesus? Now, with that question in mind, let me just invite you for a moment and ask the Lord to speak to us through His Word so that we may get His divine answers to the things that our hearts long for. Father, we come to You to do far more abundantly than we can ask or seek. Each one of us is here by Your divine will. And I ask and we plead that You would speak to our hearts. In Jesus' name, for His glory, we pray. Amen. Colossians chapter 3, beginning in verse 22. Bondservants, obey in everything those who are your earthly masters, not by way of eye service as people pleasers, but with sincerity of heart, fearing the Lord. Whatever you do, work heartily, as for the Lord and not for men, knowing that from the Lord you will receive the inheritance as your reward. You are serving the Lord Christ, for the wrongdoer will be paid back for the wrong he has done, and there is no partiality. Masters, treat your bondservants justly and fairly, knowing that you also have a master in heaven. Now, I mentioned last week that these few verses are part of a larger section where the Apostle Paul is addressing households in the ancient Near East. Those households were typically much bigger than ours. They consisted of multiple families. They consisted of slaves and servants who served. And so as Paul is writing to this church in Colossae, he knows that they have these questions of, now that we have become believers, now that we have accepted Jesus, how should that impact our day-to-day life? How does it impact what it means to be a wife? What does it mean to be a Christian child? What does parenting look like now that Jesus is Lord and Savior? Now, in our section, Paul is particularly addressing the slaves and the masters of the household. And as we saw last week, there are a number of commands, and that's primarily what we focused on in some sense last week. The commands, the things that Paul tells them to do, right? Obedience, verse 22. Bondservants, obey in everything those who are your earthly masters. Not only that, he says that this obedience must be heartily, verse 23. Whatever you do, work heartily. And not only that, he reminds the masters that they are to treat their bondservants justly and fairly. Now, the reason for all of this is found in verse 24. It's found at the end of verse 24. Whether you're a master or a slave, whether you are a wife or a husband or a child, you, in all of these things, Paul says at the end of verse 24, you are serving the Lord Christ. In other words, all of these things that we've talked about are things that show us what a life that is in service to Jesus really looks like. Now, if we are careful readers, embedded into those commands, we also find warnings or obstacles or difficulties that you and I will face as we seek to live a life in obedience to Jesus. And that's the things that I want to focus on. There are three of them. The very first one, we already touched on briefly last week, but I want to bring a different attention to it, and it's found in verses 22 and 23. Let me read verse 22. Let's see if you can catch it. As Paul begins his address, he says, "Bondservants, obey in everything those who are your earthly masters, not by way of eye service as people pleasers, but with sincerity of heart, fearing the Lord." So, what is the first obstacle that you and I face in living a life of service to Jesus? It's this. It's being a people pleaser. Being a people pleaser. As Paul takes a look at these slaves and these households, he understands that this can happen in one of two ways. One, they will do their work correctly only when observed or seen by their master. Right? In other words, so that they don't get punished. When there's an eye on them, when somebody's watching them, they are doing and working diligently. They are putting on a face so that the master will take a look and say, "Hey, okay, he's doing his job. We don't need to punish him. He's good." But also, there's another way that you can, as a slave, that you can be a people pleaser, and that is doing your work correctly to be seen by others. Right? It's the idea that I will be the best worker so that I would be identified by my master as a hardworking slave, as the one that can get the promotion. In the ancient world, slaves could be promoted, they could be educated, they could have some of their own things and things like that. And so it was the idea of, hey, if I'm the best, I can go up the corporate ladder. Now, the motivation behind both is the self. Either it is the preservation of self, or it is the advancement of self. But people-pleasing is not done as for the Lord. Now, I hope that as I'm describing that, while our circumstances are very different for every single one of us here, and you can't have a one-to-one easy correlation between ancient slavehood and our current work environment, and masters and current employers. But even besides that, our temptation to people please is as strong as ever. Now maybe this will help you. What do we mean when we say being a people pleaser? What does Paul maybe have in mind here when he says don't be people pleasers? Don't be those who do things by the way of eye service, right? To serve somebody's eye so that their eye could catch you. Let me give you three headings to think about that. One, it has to do with caring more what people think about you than God. Right? It's where your concern, chief concern in life, is what do others think of me? How, when they think me, how would they label me? Successful, unsuccessful, good, bad, cool, funny, ridiculous, attractive, unattractive, narrow-minded, smart, and on and on and on, right? What opinion do people have of me? In other words, that becomes the driving motivation in life. And this could be the good people in your life, husbands, how your husband thinks of you, how your wife, how your kids, how people at church, to maybe others who are outside of the church. Wealthy businessman, wealthy creatives or popular creatives, right? So what does people-pleasing have to do? It's when you care more about what people think about you than what God does. Another way to look at it is it's when you work harder to earn the approval of people than seek to please God. That's also an element of people-pleasing. It is when your energies are gone on to catch the eye of that person, right? That's what you wake up with. That's what happens when you step over the threshold of your work or your classroom, and you're thinking about how can you earn this person's approval? How can you earn this person's praise? Rather than, as you're stepping into whatever it is you do, as you're coming up to wash your dishes or you're turning in your math homework, you're asking the question, what does it look like to please God in this instance? What does it mean to be faithful to Him in this circumstance? Yet another way again, saying the same thing, but maybe just kind of helping us get our minds around this thing. It is the fear for your reputation before people more than your testimony about God. It is a fear for your reputation before people more than your testimony about God. As believers, we are called to represent God, who is invisible to the world who has no faith. And so we're the physical testimony. If you remember, Jesus, when he was going up to heaven in the beginning of the book of Acts, Jesus tells, "You will be my witnesses. You will testify to who I am," right? Being a people pleaser is when you are more concerned what people will think about you than what they will know about God. In other words, the question that drives you to do something is not so that I could faithfully portray what God is like and I can give credibility to the God of the Bible. The question that drives is, will I be accepted? Will I fit in? Now, it's easy to talk about this, but it's also really easy for us to be people pleasers. In fact, it's almost natural to be a people pleaser. Well, why? Well, for one, you and I see people. We don't see God. But we do see people, and not only that, people really do have a huge influence on our life, for better or for worse. Right? I mean, how your boss thinks of you at work greatly influences whether you will be promoted, how you will be treated, what kind of, you know, time frame you will be given. At school, it has a huge influence for the students, because it's a matter between being a loner or being accepted. It's a matter of being the person who's always made fun of or being the person who is accepted by others and thought of highly and is invited to all sorts of things. Right? So it's easy for us to be people-pleasing. And Paul understands that, and that's why I think when he gets back to verse 23, he actually reinforces this point. Look at verse 23. "Whatever you do, work heartily as for the Lord and not for men." I mentioned last week that that word heartily could seem like work hard, put in your full energy. It's actually not what it's talking about. It's not talking about effort, but it's talking about the intent. The word there is actually the word for soul. The word heartily is not the word for hard work, but it's the word for soul, meaning work from the very, from within your whole identity. From your deepest, innermost self. Whatever it is that you do, volunteer work, paid work, church work, homework, work at home, do it to seek to please God, not others. Now, when we take a look at this, how people pleasing is found in our lives, there's no one way that this is expressed. We all have this battle raging within us. For me as a pastor, it's one battle as I stand here and preach. For somebody who's at school, I remember those times. I was a shy kid. You probably don't believe this. But I was extremely shy. I always had a hard time with all sorts of things. Always, I was up until through more than half of high school, I was a really short kid. I know some of you struggle with the other thing because you're on the other spectrum, right? And so the short and tall people know. Because you fit out of, you don't fit into the norms, right? And that pressure, am I going to fit in? What will people around me think? Right? For men, how is this for men, right? When you see other men in the church, how are those men providing for their families? What sort of things are they able to do? How are they leading their wives? What kind of things they're able to acquire? How do other people think of these men in comparison to me? How about those of you who are married and don't have kids, right? This is especially often sensitive for women who are, for one reason or another, don't have children being married. Right? Fitting in and thinking, and especially in a culture like ours, right, where we have a lot of children and you don't have children, right? There's that feeling of tension. Do I fit in? How are people judging me? What are they thinking about me? Now, I can go on and on and on, but the question remains for each of us as we think about the obstacles that we face. This one really does come to the forefront. And we are to ask ourselves, what is my area? What is my particular struggle on where I seek to please people more than God? Where is the opinion of man rule over the opinion of heaven about me? Now, I think if we carefully look back to our passage, it offers us a way out. It helps us to think about people-pleasing, maybe in somewhat in a surprising way. If you think about it, Paul is addressing here, he doesn't talk about people-pleasing when he talks to the children or the wives. He doesn't even mention it when he talks about masters. I think the reason has to do with the question of identity. A slave in the ancient world, as I was telling you last week, was an animated tool. In other words, a hammer is a non-animated tool. A slave is an animated tool, but they both have no identity. They're objects, just a different type of an object. And slaves had no worth. The degree of their worth was only determined by their master, who thought they were a good worker or a bad worker, by their master who thought to promote them or not. But besides this, they were nobodies. And yet when we read carefully what Paul is saying here, he does something really radical for that culture and that time. He gives them an identity and a future. Remember, we talked about this last week. When Paul says that you are to do something in the Lord and you are to work heartily as for the Lord, when he says you have an ability to live a moral life, i.e. you're a real person, you're not just an animate object. But not only that, he sort of solidifies their identity when he says, knowing that from the Lord you will receive an inheritance as your reward. In other words, the whole question here revolves around the idea of identity. Identity. Where do you draw the source of meaning in your life from? What do you identify with? See, if we come back to the school example that I gave earlier, because most of you can identify with it, whether you've been out of school for a long time or you're currently in school, it is a question of identity, because you think that if you are accepted and loved and thought of highly by these people, your life then matters. Your life has significance. Your life is worth living. Do you see how it's a question of identity, of belonging? Now, Paul talks to the low of the lowest, and he says, look, your identity is not in your station in life. Your identity is not how you're identified by society. Your identity, slave, bondservant, your identity is in the fact that the God of heaven knows you, loves you, and has prepared an inheritance for you. In other words, it is a work in our hearts to be constantly reorienting and be hearing what God has to say to us about us versus the world. You know, the book of Colossians is a one, and we've done this already, and I'll invite you at home as you go, just read and look at how Paul grounds these people's identities. Every single one of theirs. He grounds them as those who've been transferred from the kingdom of God, from the kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of God's beloved Son. He talks about as those who have fruit, as those who have been redeemed, as those whose sins have been forgiven. Right? Paul is calling them to find their most significant identification as those who belong to God, not as those who belong to the world. So number one obstacle, it's being a people pleaser. In other words, finding your identity on earth in earthly things versus the things of heaven. The second obstacle is found in verses 25 and chapter 4, verse 1. It is ignoring God's warnings. To ignore God's warnings is an obstacle. Now this is almost surprising. It's almost shocking that after Paul tells these slaves that they have an inheritance, that they are serving the Lord Christ through their work, he says, for the wrongdoer will be paid back for the wrong he has done, and there is no partiality. Now, I don't know what you do. The Bible is actually replete. Old Testament and New Testament is replete with warnings to Christians. I don't know if you noticed this. Almost everywhere you read, there's a warning by Paul. There's a warning by Peter, by John, and the rest that if you do wrong, you will be punished. If you disobey, there are consequences. In other words, right after assuring the slaves of their eternal inheritance, Paul reminds them that being the child of God, having an eternal inheritance, is not a get-out-of-jail-free card. In other words, there are consequences, good and bad, for how every single one of us chooses to live our life. The fact that you are saved by grace through faith in Christ alone, the fact that as we sang that the blood of Jesus covers all of our sins, doesn't mean that there's no consequences to our actions. And I think as Christians, especially those who want to highlight the sufficiency of Jesus, who want to highlight the efficiency, the efficacy of grace, those who want to say it's only by grace, nothing that we do, often we forget that God uses a multiplicity of motivations and methods to keep us in check, to keep us in line. And this warning to the slaves is very serious. I don't know for 100% why Paul chooses to tell them what he does, but I can foresee how when they read this about the eternal inheritance and all of these things, how they would take a look at their state in life and say, you know what, I don't want to do this. I don't have to do this. I'm a child of God. You have no right to speak to me like that. Or, you know, I am pleasing to the Lord. I'm reading my scroll of the book of Colossians secretly when I'm supposed to be working. In modern terms, I'm watching YouTube during work of apologetics and how to evangelize Muslims. And those bosses are horrible because they're getting me in trouble. They're persecuting me for my faith. And Paul is saying, you have a responsibility to the station in life that you find yourselves to be faithfully doing it. And don't say that you now have a get out, you know, you get to do whatever you want and say, I'm doing it for the Lord. You can't touch me. God himself will be the one to make sure that you're punished, right? There's no partiality. In other words, God doesn't close his eyes and say, oh, this is my kid. I don't have to punish him. Now, why is this? If you turn with me a few pages over to the book of Hebrews, there's a beautiful illustration of why this is the case. The book of Hebrews, chapter 12, it's a very well-known passage, but let me read it to you. Hebrews chapter 12, beginning in verse 5. And have you forgotten the exhortation that addressed you as sons? Now listen, this is an important identifier. The writer says here, you are sons and you have an address. In other words, he's using a family metaphor. He's not using a work metaphor or anything like ethnic metaphor. He's using the most intimate, the closest metaphor. He's saying, as sons, what's this address? My son, do not regard lightly the discipline of the Lord, nor be weary when reproved by him. For the Lord disciplines the one he loves and chastises every son whom he receives. It is for discipline that you have to endure. God is treating you as sons. For what son is there whom his father does not discipline? If you are left without discipline in which all have participated, then you are illegitimate children and not sons. Besides this, we have had earthly fathers who disciplined us and we respected them. Shall we not much more be subject to the fathers of spirits and live? To the Father of spirits and live. For they disciplined us for a short time as it seemed best to them, but he disciplines us for our good, that we may share his holiness. For the moment of all discipline seems painful rather than pleasant, but later it yields the peaceful fruit of righteousness to those who have been trained by it. Now, in one sense, when we hear that, warning, we can get paranoid and we can get scared. But it's all about context, right? How you understand that. And in that, Paul is actually reminding these slaves that now that you have entered into the family of God, what I have just presented to you are the rules of the family of God, of how the family of God lives in the world. And I'm warning you, he's saying, that God, as a good, loving Heavenly Father, will exact his discipline in your life. Now, what does this maybe mean practically? I think it has to do with how we look at failure in our life. Now, we need to be very careful. I remember when I was studying in Kansas a number of years back, and we went to a theme park. And somebody crashed into me as I was backing out of a parking lot. And I came back to the house that I was living in, and the gentleman there told me, "This is God punishing you for going to a theme park." Now, I didn't do anything sinful at the theme park, okay? So it's not that I went there and I got drunk and all these things, right? I just went to enjoy the things that God has created through people. So there's an extreme to where everything that goes wrong, you tie it in and you say, this is God punishing. But the other extreme is when we look at the failures in our life, when we are insensitive to the spiritual things going on into our lives, the failures inside our families, the failures in our own lives where people don't see us, the failures at work and so forth, when we fail to recognize and think, is this God working in my heart, trying to point something out? Right? If every time something happens, all we're saying is, I got to work harder, I got to try harder, I got to figure out a way to make it work, we might miss on God touching our heart and trying to say something to it. So the second obstacle is when we ignore God's warnings. When we don't treat those sections of Scripture that are uncomfortable, that are unpleasant, when we don't take them seriously, and we fall, like Christian does in the Pilgrim's Progress. So often he falls in because he didn't listen to the instruction, and he finds himself in all sorts of places. All right. Now the first two obstacles are much more explicit in these verses. The third obstacle is a little bit more implicit. Here's what I mean by that, and try to put your thinking hat on for just a moment to think about this. Why does Paul speak the way that he does? Here's what I mean. Why does Paul here not call for the abolition of slavery? Now, if you think that that's because ancient slavery was not like, you know, Western slavery, you're only partially correct. As I mentioned before, slavery in the ancient world, in many ways, in the most significant ways, was the same. And here's what I mean. You were an object, you were owned, you had no rights. Sure, it wasn't ethnic-based and some of the other things, but it was still a horrid institution. Why doesn't Paul here use this opportunity? And in some sense, when you read it, it seems that almost he's pro-slavery, right? And this is what the southern owners in the slave, you know, in the south, this is what they used. They said, look, the Bible itself says this is okay. Why doesn't Paul here, at least to the Christian slave owners, right? Let me put it from another angle, a little bit more. At least to the Christian slave owners, Paul would say, okay, I don't anticipate impacting the whole society, but in your world, in your families, abolish slavery. Now, clearly, Paul doesn't say that we need to abolish slavery. And clearly, he intends, or the Holy Spirit through Paul intends, to use what he put in here to bring about the end of slavery. Because that's what the abolitionists in the United States and in the Great Britain and Europe used people like William Wilberforce and others. They came to the Bible and said, this is incongruent with the Bible. Now, instead of, I know I like raised up this big question and I'm going to say, I'm not going to answer it. Not quite. But I think there's something implicit here when we come in with our Western presuppositions and we want Paul to say certain things that he doesn't. Here's the third obstacle. Easing up working on our hearts. Easing up working on our hearts. Here's what I mean. It's easy to focus on the external circumstances. If I change this, if I change that, then my life would be good. The heart is really hard to work on, right? There's a saying that says, heart work is the hard work. If you read the whole Bible up until this point, you do come to realize that what happens in Genesis chapter 3 impacts us really deeply beyond brokenness, beyond being able to repair itself. In fact, the whole idea here that Paul says you have an inheritance in the future kind of foreshadows this future when there won't be any brokenness in the world. But the whole Bible speaks of the fact that every and any human institution that is to be installed ultimately falls apart. And the gospel of Jesus Christ is very careful to focus in on what is most important. In fact, if you look at the world is created materially first, and then the spiritual life is given. Redemption happens in exactly the opposite ways. First, the spirit is redeemed, and then in the life to come will be the material, total, complete material restoration of all these things. So you see, when Paul addresses here the slaves, the reason he doesn't address specifically the abolition of slavery is that he understands that to do these social things, which may be right, he's not against them, but he understands that if the heart is not worked on, there's no hope going forward. In fact, it is precisely because Paul focuses on the heart that years down the line, the seeds of equality are planted, where these people are co-brothers and sisters. When these slaves would come in and they would be elders at churches, elders over their masters. Over time, as the heart began to be worked on, as the slaves saw themselves as children of God, and as the masters saw their slaves as those who were brothers and sisters in the faith, they began to see how equality of man does not allow for something like the institution of slavery. But here's the point for us that I want us not to miss out on. You see, we're prone to think so often that what we need is a change in our circumstances. Really, the problem is that we don't have enough money in the bank. The problem really is that so-and-so does not think highly of us. The problem is that our spouse is not... The problem is that our spouse did not read their verse in Colossians 3. The problem is the pastor in the church fail to look at what is commanded to them. And the Bible actually calls us to something else. It says, those things are important and they need to be addressed. But friend, Christian, don't forget to do the work in your heart first. The work of love and acceptance. The work of fighting sin. The work of being the kind of beautiful person that Jesus has created you to be. You know, if you remember, Solomon in the book of Proverbs very wisely said in Proverbs chapter 4, verse 23, keep your heart with all what? Diligence. Depends on what version you memorize it in. For from it flow the springs of life. An obstacle that I face daily, that you face daily, that must be overcome is we want to change the world around us without changing the heart inside of us.